He played on hundreds of the greatest West Coast pop tunes of the 1960s, producing and arranging several of them. He wrote enduring standards like this Masquerade and A Song for You. He led the band for one of the most famous tours in rock music history, Mad Dogs and Englishmen, and right after that, his own road show with his group, The Shelter People, became the top grossing tour in all of America. First call session player, producer and arranger, band leader, songwriter, showman, recording artist, solo star, at different points in his life, Leon Russell was all of these things. But before any of that, he was Claude Russell Bridges, a native of Lawton, Oklahoma, a teenager at Will Rogers High School in Tulsa, who became, with several of his musical friends, a part of the very first rock and roll wave to hit America. After rising to the top of the Tulsa scene, along with such like-minded cohorts as David Gates and J.J. Cale, Leon became one of the first of the Oklahoma musicians to head for the West Coast, where his talent and drive pulled him from the ranks of nightclub performers into the rarefied atmosphere of the recording studio. In the 70s, at the peak of his powers, he returned to his hometown, and for a few magical years, Tulsa became an international crossroads for rock music, with Leon once again at the center of it all. Leon Russell's Hall of Fame music career didn't start at his former high school, but it was right here in this auditorium at this very piano that he began entertaining his classmates during lunch hours, pounding away at the latest songs from a new idiom called rock and roll. And it was here on February 9th, 2019, where this extraordinary musical tribute was held in honor and memory of Claude Russell Bridges as a dedication for the newly refurbished piano whose keys once danced underneath the fingertips of the future master of space and time.
By the time Leon arrived at Tulsa's Will Rogers High School in 1956 as a sophomore, he was a classically trained pianist with 10 years of piano lessons behind him. At the same time, a new wave of music called rock and roll had arrived on the scene. During his lunch periods, Leon would come backstage, uncover this very same piano, and give impromptu concerts. His classmates, I was one of them, would gather around and cheer him on. What we didn't realize at the time was that he was transforming his classic skills into rock and roll techniques that would distinguish his career as a performer and later inspire the likes of Sir Elton John and others to copy them.
Thing I want to ask you about is just when you made that first trip to Hollywood.
Actually, I think I went the day after my high school graduation, which would have been in 59.
So you were ready to go?
Oh, yeah. The guitar player said he had a gig, and we went out there, and it was actually Bill Pear's gig, and he didn't know anything about there was a new band coming or anything. It was really kind of embarrassing. We rode out there on the bus, and I remember getting to the bus station downtown, and I went and got in the cab and told the driver I wanted to go to the Golden Arms. He said, well, where's that? And I said, well, it's in Torrance. He said, where's Torrance? So, I got out of the cab and went and called the cab company. I said, how far is the Golden Arms from the bus station? And they said, oh, it's about 5 miles. I went back out and told them that it's only 5 miles from the bus station. He said they must be talking about the Torrance bus station. Told me to see that bus right there. I said, go get in that bus and it'll take you to Torrance for 50 cents. I said, if I take you, it'll cost you $50. That was my first travel experience in California.
And Bill Pear's gig, what did it turn out to be?
Well, the band that we put together was awful. I mean, Bill Pear's band was great. I don't know why it was about the communication. We had that job. We played one night, and it was awful. And then they hired Bill Pear back the next night. And I was out of work for about 3 months and starving to death. But let me just say, don't ever click a bus to California.
There's some romance about it, but I figure that's kind of overrated.
Yeah, it's a broken heart of romance for sure.
My uncle told me. My uncle was a master sergeant in the Air Force, and he traveled around the world operating rod and gun clubs for the Air Force. And I told him I was going to be a professional musician. He said, well, I want to tell you, it's one of the hardest jobs in the world. So you're going to have to work your ass off. You're not going to make any money. You're not going to get any appreciation, which is 90% correct. And that's what I tell him, you know, is don't expect a number one record. I mean, you may get it, but you may have to work 10 years, just like Bruce Hornsby. You know, he was an overnight sensation, but he he was messing with that stuff for 8 or 9 years before he had that hit. And a lot of times that happened. Glenn, the same way. It's a rough business. Well, there's a period in my life when I was trying to write standards. A guy, a baritone player for Tower of Power, came up to me one day. Doc, I think his name is. And he said, Leon, how do you get all those people to cut your records? He said, I've had 12 number one records. Nobody has ever cut any of them but Tower of Power. And I said, well, maybe your lick's too complicated. I don't know. I mean, standards, when you write standards, when you first hear a standard, it sounds just like a shitty little tune, you know. And then you come back and you hear it later, and then you hear it 20 years later. They're different. When I wrote Masquerade, I was trying to write a standard. I wrote Song for You. I was trying to write a song that Ray Charles and Frank Sinatra could sing, a blues song that Ray Charles and Frank Sinatra could sing. 20 years ago, I don't know what the number is now, but 20 years ago, Song for You had been cut 129 times. I don't know. That was before Ray Charles cut it. Masquerade was cut 43 times before George Benson cut it. I mean, I try to write standards. I don't try to write hits. I liked Song for You. Herb Alpert had bought that grand from Western Studio 3. It was my favorite grand piano in Los Angeles. And Herb bought it. And when I played that, I'd never played it that way before. I never played that intro before. I just, all off the top of my head, I mean, which is the story of my life, really. And basically, I was trying to sing like Bonnie Bramlett. At that time, we was all trying to sing like Bonnie Bramlett, you know. And she was a person that had a quite unusual singing style. And all the girls were copying it, and I was trying to sing it on that song. A limousine driver told me one time, he's in New York, who's hauling Aretha Franklin, and he got to the destination, and that song came on. And she said she made him sit there and play that 20 times. She listened to it over and over again.
In my life and time, I've sung a lot of songs, I made some bad rhymes. I racked down my life on stages with 10,000 people watching. Whoa. But we're alone now and I'm singing this song to you. Remember when we were together? Whoa, whoa, whoa. We were alone and I was singing this song to you. We were alone and I was singing this song to you. Cause we're alone now and I'm singing my song. Singing this song to you.
Can you name the piano player in all of these songs?
On my mind, little old lady, wish they all could be in California.
Leon Russell, he was quite a study. When he first came to town, he lived at a funky motel down on Sunset Boulevard, and there was no telephone there, and he had no phone at all. And he used to just hang around the studios and kind of get jobs that way, you know, hanging around.
Real country boy.
Yeah, a real country boy from Oklahoma. And we said, Leon, if you want to work in this town, you got to get a telephone so people can call you to work. Oh, really? Oh, really?
Whatever.
Okay, I'll go out and get myself a phone pretty soon, then, you know.
He was fabulous.
We were on this day with Glenn Campbell, and they brought Leon in, and I'll never forget. And Leon panicked. He was sitting there, and Glenn says, Leon, just play that shit you did in Oklahoma. He says, they don't know nothing here. So Leon played Leon Russell,
yeah, right.
And all of a sudden, they don't know nothing. That was his style. That's what they loved. That's what he did from there on it.
He had that magic touch on the piano. I don't know what you call down-home Southern-style piano playing that he did. It was magnificent.
I was so taken with Al DeLore and his capability. Later on, he put Al playing electric piano, which was just a fill kind of, I mean, just something to fill up the sound, with Leon Russell playing the acoustic piano. And I said, gee, you know, I thought Al was great. And he says, no, Leon Russell, man, he's got hands. He can reach octaves his... You can't beat that.
Leon never said boo to anybody, you know. He just come in, play his piano, you know. And so one day he came to work completely drunk. I mean, so drunk. And he went in and he sat down at the piano, and he and who was playing next to him? Don Randy, I think. And everybody, I mean, he was actually talking. He never spoke. And everybody was like coming in, did you see Leon? And so everyone was like just looking at him, you know, and he was being really funny too, because I never heard him say a word. So Philip was like totally knocked out, but then finally he wanted the session to begin, you know, and And Leon was just doing, you know, all this kind of crazy stuff. And so Philip said, you know, Leon, have you ever heard of the word respect? And Leon jumped up on the table, on the piano, and he said, Philip, have you ever heard of the word you? And everybody, I mean, that was, I mean, they couldn't get it together for half an hour. People were like dying on the floor. I mean, tears rolling in the studio because it was just, it's one of those, you know, the weirdest thing you ever saw.
My favorite Leon Russell story is, it's 8 o'clock at night, and there was an 80-piece orchestra.
Oh, boy.
No Leon Russell. Where the hell is Leon? 8-5, 8-6, 8-7. Suddenly the door opens, all the guys get real hushed, and Leon had a limp. He's got something wrong orthopedically. And of course the piano's all the way on the other side. Takes him about 4 or 5 minutes, not a word spoken, all the way. He limps over to the piano, sits down, fixes himself, pulls up the lid, and looks to the booth. And from the booth comes Ben Barrett's voice saying, Leon, don't you ever, ever be late again. You're holding up this whole recording. And Leon closes the piano, gets up, and limps all the way back and out. Never played a note.
He left.
Yeah, he had his own brand of fungu.
Yeah, he sure did.
I was playing on one of George Harrison's records one day. And we were in take 168. And I went up to him and said, George, do you want me to play the same thing 168 times, or do you want me to play 168 different things? This is driving me crazy. I didn't like to do that. But some people, I mean, he was overdubbing on my wedding album. I had one of his songs on there. He just played a guitar solo, and it was great. I said, well, that's good. He said, oh, no, that's not quite good. Let me play it again. So he played, I had a 40-track machine, and he played 25 more solos. I kept all of them. And we got to the end of solo 25, and I said, well, George, listen to this one, see what you think. I played it, and he said, well, that's great. What is that? And I said, that's number one.
Just myself and 40 friends. In the name of copper power, out here on the road again, with mad dogs and English men.
Hollywood changed my dream.
Oklahoma was all I'd ever seen. And I was getting older. The memories of the Greyhound were fading quickly past. In the lonely restaurant windows, an empty hourglass reflects the human hunger for the question never asked. I only had my time for spending.
First song in music history to occupy the number one spot on the jazz, pop, and rhythm and blues charts simultaneously. George Benson's cover of the song won a Grammy for Record of the Year in 1976.
Are we really happy with this lonely game we play? Looking for words to say. Searching but not finding, understanding anyway. We're lost in this masquerade. Both afraid to say we're just too far away from being close together at the start. We're trying to talk it over, but the words got in the way. We're lost inside this lonely game we play. Thoughts of leaving disappear each time I see your eyes. No matter how hard I've tried to understand the reason that we carry on this way. We're lost in this masquerade.
I'm up on the tight wires. One side's ice and one is fire. It's a circus game with you and me. I'm up on the tight rope. One side's hate and one is hope. But the top hat on my head is all you see. wire seems to be the only place for me. A comedy of errors and I'm falling. Like a rubber neck giraffe, you look into my past. Well, maybe you're just too blind to see. I'm up in the spotlight. Oh, does it feel right? Well, the altitude really gets to me. I'm up on a tight white, flanked by life and the funeral pyre. But I ain't gonna show you to see.
I grew up listening to so many different piano players, starting with Little Richard and Jerry Lee Lewis, Fats Domino, Floyd Kramer, going through the whole roster till suddenly in the late 60s, I heard a record by Delaney and Bonnie. And I thought, wow, this guy who plays on this record, he's got everything I like. He's got soul and gospel and kind of bluegrass and everything going. And then I went to see Delaney and Bonnie in England, and I saw him, and he looked like something from outer space. He was pretty amazing. But then he did the Joe Cocker, Mad Dogs and Englishmen, and then he really looked like something from outer space. He became the master of space and time, and he wore that hat and those aviator glasses, and he looked like a mean motherfucker. I met him after the show. And not only was he sweet and kind, he gave me a recipe for my voice, which I still use to this day. And he asked me to do some dates with him. And listen, he was my idol. To meet him, I was shaking. For me, he sang, he wrote, and he played just how I wanted to do it. Only recently have I discovered how many people's records he played on. Leon played on Bing Crosby, Johnny Mathis, Doris Day, Dean Martin, Herb Alpert, Frank Sinatra, Strangers in the Night. Da-da-da-da-da. Remember that? The Ventures, the Everly Brothers, Del Shannon, Duane Eddy, Bobby V, Bobby Darin, Jan and Dean, Let There Be Drums, Sandy Nelson. That was Leon. The Fleetwoods, Come Softly to Me. That was Leon. Connie Francis, The Crystals, The Ronettes, every Phil Spector record. The Byrds, Mr. Tambourine Man. Delaney and Bonnie. The Beach Boys, every Beach Boys record, including Pet Sounds. J.J. Cale, Harry Nilsson, Bob Dylan, Joe Cocker, Freddie King, and B.B. King, just to name some of them that he played on. I lost touch with Leon in the early 1970s. And in 2009, I was in Africa, and I was shaving, and I put some music on the iPod, and I pressed Leon Russell, and I started to sob. And that music took me back to one of the greatest times of my life. And I thought, I have to call this person up. He gave me such a wonderful start in my life. He meant so much to me, and I haven't talked to him for so long. So I called him, and I said, would you like to do an album? And he said, sure. Last year in January, Leon and I embarked upon what was one of the greatest years of my life, both musically and personally, because I got to know the man that I never knew. I got to spend time with him in the studio. He was frail when he came in the studio. He had a 5.5-hour brain operation. And suddenly, with the love from the musicians in the studio and all the other peers that came to pay tribute to him, he became stronger. And I said to him, there's one thing I want for you. I want people to acknowledge you for what you've done, to remember you for what you've written, what you've played on, and for you to be proud again of what you've done. And I want you to be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And here we are a year later, and he's in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And You know, at the end of the year, I phoned him up and said, Leon, it's been a great year. He said, yeah, I got a new bus. And I've got to know and love someone who I treasured as a musician, treasured as an artist. So it's my great pleasure to show you a film about Leon Russell.
I feel like I have to say, if you leave this place tonight and you don't feel like you had a religious experience, why don't you just get your money back? Because I don't need it. You hear me? 2, 3, 4. Roll away,
stone. Oklahoma, at the time I was living there, was a dry state. Consequently, there wasn't any liquor laws, and I was able to start playing in nightclubs when I was 14.
Don't leave me laying here. What will they do in 2000 years?
Bangladesh concert was really an opportunity for me to go out and play out all my rock and roll fantasies that I'd had ever since I was 5 or 6.
A couple of numbers from Leon.
And I kind of have the theory that really most writers just have one song. If you can get that one right, well, you're doing okay.
I love you in a place where there's no space and time. I love you for my life, you are a friend of mine. And when my life is over, remember when we were together, oh, we were alone and I was singing this song to you.
An American legend, an American icon, Leon Russell.
Great to be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. But I have to tell you something else that's also great. About a year ago, Elton came and found me in a ditch by the side of the highway of life. He took me up to the high stages with big audiences and treated me like a king. And the only thing I can say is, bless your heart. Also, I want to say thank you very much. I appreciate it. And hallelujah.
I've been so many places in my life and time. I sung a lot of songs, I made some bad rhymes. I acted out my life on stage and with 10,000 people watching, but we're alone. Now I'm singing this song for you. I know your image of me, what I hope to be. I treated you unkindly, can't you see? No, if I'm more important to me, darling, can't you please see through me when we're alone? And I'm singing this song for you. You taught me precious secret, the truth withheld and nothing. You came out in front, I was hiding. But now I'm so much better. If these words don't come together, listen to the melody, my love. It's in their
Leon Russell.